Polycythemia is defined by the presence of excessive red blood cells. Among other issues, this can result in hyperviscous blood, which is prone to clotting. Let's first talk about the different types and causes of polycythemia, and then focus on polycythemia vera. Polycythemia can be primary or secondary. Primary polycythemia, or polycythemia rubra-vera, is a disease where mutations in bone marrow hematopoietic stem cells cause the excessive production of red blood cells. 90% of the time, this is due to a mutation in JAK2, which is a tyrosine kinase involved in erythropoietin receptor signaling. This means that EPO, which is usually produced by the kidneys in response to hypoxia, is not even needed for the proliferation of red blood cells. On the other hand, secondary polycythemia is caused by excessive EPO. This can be divided into appropriate and inappropriate causes. Appropriate causes are normal physiological adaptations due to hypoxia from things like COPD, sleep apnea, and high altitudes. Secondary causes can also be due to inappropriate increases in EPO. An example of this would be from renal cell carcinoma, which can have a paraneoplastic syndrome associated with the excessive production of this hormone. Let's look at the signs and symptoms of polycythemia. Clinically, it's often detected as an incidental finding in asymptomatic patients. However, it can present with features of hyperviscosity, like visual changes, mucosal bleeding, and neurological issues like headaches. More specific features include splenomegaly, which occurs because the organ needs to work harder to filter the excessive cells. People can also suffer generalized pruritus, which occurs in about 50% of patients. Plethora or reddening, particularly in the face and neck, is common as well. Finally, erythromelalgia, which is an intense burning pain and reddening, primarily of the feet and hands, is a telltale sign of polycythemia. Two important complications to be aware of are thrombotic events and post-polycythemia myelofibrosis. Thrombotic events like DVTs and myocardial infarctions and strokes are common, but it's important to know they can also occur in unusual places, like the hepatic veins. This is also known as Budd-Chiari syndrome. Additionally, polycythemia vera can progress to what's known as a spent phase. This is characterized by myelofibrosis and the development of anemia. This occurs because the excessive load on the bone marrow leads to scarring and the eventual inadequate production of cells. I think there are three important things to remember when investigating polycythemia after an initial full blood count shows relatively high red blood cells and hemoglobin. Firstly, you need to exclude both appropriate and inappropriate causes of secondary polycythemia based on your clinical suspicion from the history and physical exam. Additional investigations might help, like spirometry and chest x-rays in case there's a potential lung pathology, or sleep studies for sleep apnea. After excluding secondary causes, the two most important tests are checking for a JAK2 mutation from the peripheral blood and determining the serum levels of EPO. In polycythemia vera, RBC proliferation occurs without needing EPO. This actually results in a suppressed low serum EPO level. On the other hand, secondary causes of polycythemia will often have very high levels of EPO. Polycythemia vera can be managed with aspirin for thrombosis, venesection to achieve a normal hematocrit, in higher risk patients, cytoreductive therapies using chemotherapy like hydroxyurea might be indicated. And finally, it's important for a hematologist to help coordinate a patient-centered, multidisciplinary team for optimal management. To help you remember this, I just think about polycythemia vera being as easy as 1, 2, 3, A, B, C. Firstly, polycythemia vera is the primary type of polycythemia. There are two main complications, which are thrombotic events like Budd-Chiari syndrome and myelofibrosis. There are three things to remember when investigating it. You should exclude secondary causes, you should check the EPO levels, and you should determine if the patient has a JAK2 mutation. Finally, management is as easy as A, B, C. Aspirin, bloodletting, and sometimes chemotherapy. Thank you for watching Townsend Teaching. Don't forget to click on the notification bell, like, comment, and subscribe, and watch out for new videos coming up.